Yeah. was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I hear you call. Father, you worked your way. I have no righteousness of my own. I have no right to draw near your throne. Father, you love. Did could ever atone. Jesus, you made my
You are good, good. Oh, you are good. Oh, hey, Fellowship family, and welcome to another week of FBC Online. You know, you just heard the Fender, and the drums are okay, but they don't hold a candle to the drumming of Toby, or Tenacious T, as we call him, who studied at the Jack Black School of Music and last summer learned the greatest song in the world. So what I need you to do is, I need you to post using the hashtags FBC Topeka and FBC Hi-Crest, who did it better, Jonathan or Tenacious T, Lil Toby? And this is just a reminder that today during service that we're going to take communion, so if you don't have your elements together, this would be a good time to get those. If you have any prayer requests or needs that we can help meet, then you can find links to those areas in the message description or in the links in our chats. And now we're going to toss it to Bill for our call to worship.
Hey, Fellowship family. It's great to be with you today. And to start us out, I'd like to read from Psalm 145, which is just one of my favorite pictures of what we get to do together as we sing and worship. And this is what it says. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. And his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. When we do this, when we get to sing together, you and I have the opportunity to declare his greatness, to speak of his righteousness, to commend his works and all that he has done to each other as brothers and sisters, as family members. And that's what we have the opportunity to do right here and right now. So let's lift our voices. Let's sing to the Lord and let's sing of what he has done.
Shines like the sun, all love is brilliant, the King.
Now you would take my place. Now you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done.
Is it he? Isn't he wonderful? as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the joy you found. Thank you, Lord, a treasure we found in you.
At Fellowship, one of the things we do to remember our ability to approach our Heavenly Father is by remembering His invitation to commune with Him, to sit at His table. And we accept that invitation through the act of communion. Here at Fellowship, you don't have to be a partner in order to take part in this act of remembrance with us. But we ask that only those who have stepped across the line of faith do so. And we do that for two reasons. One, we don't want you to do anything that you don't understand. And two, we don't want you to do anything that you don't agree with. Today, we're going to be leading you through taking part in the elements from home. So you can do this with water or juice or crackers or bread or whatever you have at home. And if you don't have those and haven't collected those elements, you can do that now as we prepare to transition. And for just a second here, I want you to take a moment to think about what areas of your life have you been reluctant to approach the God of the universe with? What areas of your life have you been reluctant to open up and just allow God to see into your heart and to your soul in those areas where you can be fully known and fully loved? Take a moment just to consider that right now. On the night before He was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and He broke it into pieces. And He said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way, He took the cup of wine after supper and He said, "This cup represents the new covenant between God and His people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this to remember me as often as you drink it. For every time you drink of this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until He comes again." Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, which allows us to openly and freely approach you, the God of the universe. It's such a great honor and pleasure and privilege that we have that we don't have to hide, that no area of our life has to live in the shadows, that we can come to your altar, that we can be who you truly made us to be, that we can know that we can trust you with every part of us, that no part has to be held back, that you don't judge us based on our performance, but on the goodness of your character, on the sacrifice of your Son. And through that act, Father, that we have received grace, which allows us the freedom to call you Abba, Father, that we are in a relationship that is not based on what we do and what we don't do, but on what your Son did for us on the cross and how the Holy Spirit raised Him from the grave on that third day. So, Father, in this time, if there's any area of our lives that we've been reluctant to turn over to you, to expose to you our worries, our anxieties, our fears, Father, during this time of pandemic, we ask that we would open those areas up, that we would entrust them to you, Father, and that we would have joy everlasting. We pray this in your darling Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, Fellowship family, it's always my joy to get into God's Word with you and to seek what God would have us do and who we God would have us be as a result of Him speaking to us in His Word. And as we continue with our online services, I just want to let you know we're trying to stay up to date with everything that the government is doing as they think about restarting our society. And we'll keep you up to date on all the news and all of our responses to that. And I hope you'll continue to pray for us to have wisdom and to be effective and to be sensitive and wise in the midst of this. So we really appreciate your prayers. All right, so we're continuing this series called Faithful, and we're looking at the values of being faithful with what God has entrusted to us, our finances. And we started out with prayer, right? To be faithful in prayer with what God has entrusted to us. And we literally believe that prayer is the most we can do. It's not the last and the least. It's the most that we can do. And so it's so important if you're going to make wise financial decisions, and especially as we talk about a plan today, you're going to have to seek the Lord through prayer. It's the most we can do. Secondly, we talked about the object of all of life, which is the kingdom of God. And that is what Jesus taught about. That's what Jesus called us to. So if we're going to follow Jesus, our lives need to be invested, not just dabbling, but all in on the kingdom of God. And everything around the kingdom of God is priceless and it's eternal. God, His Word, and people. And we're most fulfilled, we're most alive when we're following Jesus and pouring our lives into things that money could never buy, but things that last for eternity. And so now we're going to get to the very practical side of things. And we're going to look at the value of a plan. And just, I got a question as we begin. Do you have a financial plan? I mean, do you have something where you could say to money where it needs to go so money doesn't tell you what to do, okay? And that's the value of a plan, is it gives leadership, it gives a direction, it's intentional, it's wise. And so my question is, do you have one? And I know what I might have just created in many living rooms across Topeka. There might be the glance between husband and wives. One says, we need a plan. The other one says, I love to be free. I want to spend it all. And that's very normal. So we're going to broach this topic joyfully, but we're going to approach it courageously because I think God wants to grow us in this area because this is a key area that God's Word is not seen in the same way by different people. And so it can divide more than it can unite. And I believe God wants to unite us in relationship with Him, in relationship with each other on this. And so I know in my own life, if I don't have a plan, things will plan my life for me. And I just can't afford to do that anymore. I'm 55 years old and I'm maturing as a man of God, and I just know that just because I've experienced life with a plan and life without a plan, and I can't afford not to have a plan. So what I want to do is I want to take us to a point in Scripture where we can learn about a plan. And so we're going to look in the book of Genesis. If you have your Bibles, open up with me to Genesis chapter 41. And this is a story within the life of a greater story in the life of Joseph. And so Genesis 41, if you'll turn there with me, you'll find just on that first verse of Genesis chapter 41 that Pharaoh, the leader of this mega empire called Egypt, has a dream and no one can figure it out. And he asks all his wise men to interpret it. No one can. And then it shifts to a distant place like a prison, in jail, in a pit, in a dungeon, and there's Joseph. And Joseph has a history of interpreting dreams. And one of Pharaoh's courts remembers how many years before Joseph interpreted a dream when he was in prison with Joseph. And so he says, I know of someone who can do it. So Joseph literally is taken from the prison. He's shaven, he's put on with some clothes, and he's brought right before Pharaoh, and Pharaoh tells him his dream. Here's the dream. Pharaoh had a vision that there were seven full and healthy cows, and they were eating alongside the Nile River. And up attacking them were were ugly and lean cows that came and overtook them and killed them. And then he had another dream. And it was a picture of seven stalks or heads of grain. And they were plump and they were healthy. And then as the wind blew, seven other kind of really emaciated heads of wheat came in and overtook them. And he didn't know what this would mean. And so Joseph says, my God has taught me how to interpret dreams, and I will interpret this dream. He said, Pharaoh, ultimately, these seven cows represent 7 years, and those seven good heads of wheat represent 7 years. And in the next 7 years, you're going to have prosperity. There's going to be bountiful harvests, and there's going to be prosperity unlike anything ever seen in Egypt. And then they're going to be followed by seven bad years, 7 years of famine, 7 years of no rain, and everything about the bountiful, prosperous years are going to be forgotten. They're going to be that bad. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to store up all the produce of the land for the next 7 years. Look at what it says, and we'll point to it. We'll point to it right now. In Genesis chapter 41, look at verse 33 to 36. So he says, now therefore, let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh proceed to appoint overseers over the land and take 1/5 or 20% of the produce of the land of Egypt during the 7 plentiful years. And let them gather all the food of those good years that are coming and store up grain under the authority of Pharaoh for food in the cities, and let them keep it. That food shall be a reserve for the land against the 7 years of famine that are to occur in the land of Egypt, so that the land may not perish, though the famine. So this was something brand new, but it was a courageous plan, and it would require them to trust God. Again, Egypt did not trust God. Joseph did. God was with Joseph in prison. He was with him during prosperity. And that's the contrast that you get. And with this plan, God used a people that weren't worshiping God, and he blessed them because he gave them this plan. And so when we look at a plan, there's some things we can take away that applied at the time of Joseph and apply to us today. When we define a plan, we plan for this reason. We plan because a plan is a wise direction leading to a joyful destination. Think with me that your life is a journey, and every decision that you make with your life is a direction. And as you make more and more decisions, that direction is going to move you into a destination. And so maybe you're there now. You're not in a good destination. You're not in a good place, as some might say. And so when you look at not being in a good place, whether it's finances, whether it's relationships, I bet you can kind of look back at some of the decisions that were made previous to this and go, you would probably look back at it just like I do in so many things in my life. And we go, man, I shouldn't have taken that direction. I saw a better direction, but I chose to go with a want rather than a need. And as a result, that's the situation I'm in. And many of us never plan to be in the destination we're in. But we can look back and go, when I made that decision, when I took that direction, that's one of the reasons I'm here. And so a plan, when we're making a plan, we want to be wise with it. And that's exactly the word you get with what Joseph shares in that plan. Set up, Pharaoh, a wise and discerning person to implement this plan so that you will be a wise leader in this land. Later then, as this story progresses, Pharaoh makes this comment because he puts Joseph as this wise and discerning man. He says, is there any person that you know of who has more of the spirit of God in them? Here you have a non-believer talking about another God, saying, I've never seen a man whose God was so powerful through his life because of this plan. And that's what we're going to look at, is the importance of having a wise direction, of taking a wise direction with our finances that leads to a joyful destination. Now, we don't always think of joy being around money, but we certainly use money to take us to places that bring us happiness. And that's what I've learned. As we look at at finances. There's things that I want, and there's things that I need. And discernment will help us to choose which one is best, okay? And so whether it's a new upgrade on a phone, whether it's a new gadget, whether it's a vacation to take, or maybe not taking now that everybody is still closer to home, or an adventure that you want to take, or an upgrade, or here's probably something that's real close to home, a home improvement project. I mean, we're spending so much on our homes, and yet we find the money to do it. We find the resources to get what we want, which is why, if we're going to be wise, we have to start with prayer. We have to seek the Lord. We have to ask not what my will is, but God, what's your will? What's your kingdom in my life look like? And that's why a plan. A plan's a wise direction leading to a joyful destination. So let's look at now the components of the plan, because there's components of Joseph's plan given to him by God that still apply to us today. And I would just say this, that as we talk about this plan and the components of the plan, there is a plan. If you choose not to plan, there's a plan for you. Trust me, we live in a very consumeristic culture. And no matter what income you make, there's a plan for you. You're marketed far more personally than you ever have been in the present. And so I look at that, and you know, you can be looking at something on Amazon, and all of a sudden you go over to Facebook, and all of a sudden you see that same thing marketed to you. Why? Because people have a plan for you. Marketers have a plan for you. And it doesn't matter what you make, the home you live in, the car you drive, the clothes you wear, the schools your kids go to, the activities they compete in, the opportunities we provide for our kids or even for ourselves. And what it turns into, if the world's going to have a plan for me, it's going to be just fueled by comparison, by dissatisfaction. And comparison is the thief to joy. And I believe God wants us to experience his joy, not just in eternal life, but joy in the now. So let's look at these three components of a plan, and then I'll tell you how we can respond to it. And the first one is this. The first component of a plan is provision. It's provision from God. Did you know that God wants to provide for your needs? That's not a wrong thing. I love what Paul says to Timothy. He says that God has generously given the things that we have for our enjoyment. So it's not wrong to enjoy the things God has given us, but we must be wise and discerning between the things we need and must have versus the things that we want to have that go over a line. Now, remember who we have in God. And we opened up in our first week where we looked at Psalm 145. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. That's the God we have. It says even before that, that the eyes of all look to you and you give them their food or their fruit in due season. I mean, we have a God who loves to give us and loves to provide for us. Now, in Joseph's plan, God provided for Egypt. He provided for them in a prosperous, bountiful way, overflowing for 7 years. And if they would have lived on it all and ate it all and spent it all, they would have had huge destruction when those seven next years would happen, when those 7 years of famine would happen. And so God told them, he told them, save during this time. I will provide for you and I will take care of you, but that's not the only part of a plan. Now, before we move on, let's talk about what provision looks like. For us, it includes things like food and shelter, a transportation, whether that's a bus or a bike or a car, clothing, the things that we'll wear. And then there's other things that we just live with in our culture. Like we live with insurance and having to have insurance in our cars to a certain level. And so there's things that we have to pay for utilities that keep our houses cool or warm, depending on the time of year, of water that we need, and all those types of things. Those are provisions. And as we look at that, I just want you to take some time this week and just look at what did we spend in the past and what's our plan for this. And maybe it's good to ask the question, what must I have, rather than what do I really want to have? what must I have, will move you to at least see the provision of God in your life, to receive that provision and to live wisely inside of that provision. Okay, so that's the first part of that. And now let's move to the second part. So part two of that plan with Joseph was safety for uncertainties. Now, God happened to give them a dream that was prophecy of what the next 7 years would look like. And he told them to save 1/5 or 20% a year to prepare a reserve, okay? Now, some people would say, and some Christians would even say, it's wrong to have savings. And I disagree strongly with that. And Genesis 41 is a case in point. It's not wrong to have savings. It's wrong to hoard. It's wrong to have so much security and savings that you forget about God and you become self-dependent. But it's never wealth or having more than enough is never a sin. It's the love of money that's the root of all evil. And so you can make that choice to either love your things or love God with your things. And that's what we're called to as followers of Jesus, is to love God and what he blesses with us and what he provides for and the excess or the surplus that he gives us. Be wise with that also, because all of it is his. We just happen to be stewards. We're money managers for him. So when it comes to safety for uncertainties, just like Joseph kept 20% out there, we're called to save an amount. It may not be 20%. It may start at 1% or 2%, but it needs to start somewhere. And what this means is that it answers the question, what will I do if my income stops? Now, some of you, your income has stopped. And so we want to help you with that. And God has provided us with, as a church, with resources to come alongside and help you. So we want to know about that. Let us know. You can get in on the chat or you can text and let us know about your need. But think about your own personal provision right now. This helps you plan for the things that are unplanned. This helps you deal with the surprise of the unexpected. Now, think with me, just 2 months ago, nowhere in my mind did I even comprehend of a crisis like the one that we're in right now. I mean, sure, 2 months ago, we heard about this virus that was out there, but now, it's a very clear and it's a present reality, whether it's the virus or the response or reaction against the virus. This is an amazing time and a huge time for us to have safety for uncertainties. And if we were to just project out the next several months, it doesn't look like things are just going to snap back and everything's going to be perfect. And so that's why this uncertain time is so important to have some safety in that. Now, there is a stark reality. And again, no guilt and shame with this, but going into this crisis, 40% of Americans did not have $400 to meet an unexpected expense. And so that's a daunting figure. How many millions of people, 40% of our population, did not have $400 to meet an unexpected expense. And so that's why margin or savings to help you cover an unexpected expense will move you more into joy than it will worry and panic and fear. And I'll just be quite frank. If I didn't have some safety in my personal finances for uncertainties, when an uncertainty would hit, I'm just telling you who I am here, I'd be angry. I'd be mad. I'd be frustrated. I start looking at what everyone around me is spending and I compare and I'd get bitter and I'd resent that and I'd turn into the man I don't want to be. I don't want to be. And that's why this helps us meet uncertainties. So, hey, something's happening and you may have already received it. And if you haven't spent it yet, don't. Put it here, your stimulus check. Okay, some of you might be getting $1,200 or $2,400 or more. And that's something you just don't go at this uncertain time. Just don't spend it all. Take something and start some safety for an uncertainty. As it worked for Egypt and as it worked through the life of Joseph, it can work for us today. So take a look at that and be wise. Be wise with the direction of cash or inflow that, God has given you through our government and be wise with it so that it leads you to joy and not bitterness or anger. Okay, and the third part of a plan is an opportunity for blessing. This has to do with generosity. And if you think about this, they received so much through the prosperous years, and they were wise for building a safety amount for uncertainties that they could be a blessing. They could be a blessing. And I would just say, whenever it comes to money, we love opportunities and we loathe obligations, okay? Obligations are things we've got to do no matter what. They're utility bills, they're payments, they're taxes, all those kinds of things. We must do them. And if we don't do them, look out. Things are going to shut down pretty quickly. But if we pay those off and we have the more money we have for opportunities, the more joy that tends to come into our lives. We love opportunities. But none of us gets great joy out of paying a utility bill. But we get great joy when we see something moving the gospel from one life to another, from one location to another. And Genesis chapter 41 is that personal story of the life of Pharaoh and Joseph and the plan that God brought into their lives. But they had no idea in the midst of this plan, even in the 7 years of prosperity, God was still working out his purposes in the life of Joseph. And what happens from Genesis 41 all the way to chapter 51 is it zooms out and it shows you a bigger plan, a larger plan of blessing through this plan of God. Because Joseph was of a family of Jacob. And Jacob had 12 sons, 11 of the other brothers that Joseph never got along with. And they actually sold him into slavery to Egypt and just got him away from their father because they were jealous of him. And what happens is way back in Canaan, that family of Jacob, during the famine, actually went back to Egypt and they meet Joseph. And Joseph reveals himself as their brother. And they get so afraid, but Joseph embraces them and loves them and blesses them and brings Jacob, their father, and their families all the way back to Egypt. And in the end of this story, Jacob realizes that Joseph is no longer dead, as the brothers said he was, but he's alive, and he blesses Joseph and his sons. He blesses his 11 other sons, and then he dies. And then Joseph lives and dies a blessed man. And so as you look at this whole book of Genesis, this word blessing is just popping up wherever it goes. Alan Ross, one of my seminary professors, who wrote a book, big, huge book, it's about that big, and it was called Creation and Blessing. And it goes through this whole book of Genesis, and it keeps popping up all over that book of Genesis. Blessing, blessing, blessing. The call of Abraham, I will bless you and make you into a great nation. The call of Jacob, I will bless you. The call of Isaac, I will bless you. The call of Joseph, I will bless you, and you will be a blessing. And all the world comes in because of this plan of God with everything from provision to safety to opportunity. See, God is working about something, working something so much greater than just how much you make and where it all goes. And that plan is so important that God can bring it together and do incredible things, because God takes whatever we plan and he will use it for his purposes. And Joseph, at the end of Genesis, in Genesis 50, he says, what you meant for evil, God meant for good, the salvation of many people. And God is in the saving business. And we invest in him when we have opportunity for blessing others, whether it's giving to the church or giving to someone in need, where it's giving to a mission group or giving to an organization that advances the gospel. I mean, we all have an opportunity to go all in on being a blessing, but it will require us to have a plan. So I mentioned to you about my life with and without a plan. And I will tell you, this has been one of the areas of greatest joy, that as I have been entrusted with more and more throughout my life, this has been an area my wife and I, Cheryl, have grown over and over and over. Our passion is helping people find and follow Jesus Christ. And when we've told money where it should go, it never told us what we should do. And it really added to our lives. And we really believe this from the bottom of our hearts. It's better and we're more blessed to give than to receive. And it allowed us to seek out opportunities in our family, with our friends, with our church, with our city, and even beyond us in our world. So as we think about the plan, and as you just consider this for your life, that the plan is a wise direction leading to a joyful destination. Let me just ask you a question. When's the best time to start a plan? You can just share it. I may hear it. Here, what? Shoot out. When's the best time to make? Okay, here's the answer. 20 years ago. It is. It's like the best time to plant an oak tree was 20 years ago. But the second best time to plant something or to plan is right now, is to begin today. So what's your first move in choosing a wise direction for the finances God has entrusted to you, leading them to a joyful, and your family and anyone around your life into a joyful destination? I just want to encourage you. Some of you, it might be, I need some help. Well, let us know right now. Just let us know where you're at. We'd love to come alongside you. God has provided resources for us to help you. Some of you will go, wow, I got to the end of the month. I didn't know where it all went. I need to get a handle on it. And I would tell you, seek wisdom. You know, we've been very invested in Financial Peace University, and that I've never seen a better thing that can help people develop a plan than Financial Peace University. But there's also other things that others around here have discovered, like Crown Ministries. Some of you have a trusted financial advisor, and I've had one for many years now, and I've become wiser because I put myself around people who can help me develop a plan, because I know my life without one, and I know my life with one, and I have more joy when I have a plan. So I've experienced both the joy and the anger of having a plan and not having a plan. And I would just tell you this, choose this day a plan. And as you do that, as you think about what's your first step, I want you to just think about that first step of beginning with provision, safety, and opportunity. And just start working through that and start in each one of those areas and begin with something in each of those areas. And as God entrusts you with more, to deepen those and bless those. Folks, there has never been a more important time in the history of my lifetime that I could say this to you in a more practical way, to begin with a plan, to start with a plan that will tell money where it needs to go so that it won't tell you what to do. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time in our history, this time of uncertainty. Lord, we don't know what to do. But we've looked to you now in your word. You've shown us of how you worked in a time of crisis and a time of prosperity, because nothing stops you from working. And so, Lord, in this time of crisis, in this time of uncertainty, work in your people. Help us develop a plan that leads to a joyful destination so that money doesn't tell us what to do. And we can make our lives more about you than a slave to one more thing. We thank you, and may Jesus be honored and glorified, and we look forward to the future blessing of this word in the lives of each of our people. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
While Pastor Joe was speaking today, did something click? Did something go off inside of you that said, I need a plan? Yes, this is a difficult time, and there's a lot of things that can be on your mind and concerning, but did something go off saying, I need a plan? Well, first of all, I want to let you know that when it comes to what happens for eternity, God has already made a plan. And it was his son, Jesus Christ, who came and gave his life for you. And maybe as you listen, you realize that you had no plan for eternity. If you're sensing that that's where you're at and you want to take your next step, you want to step across the line of faith, you want to put your trust in Jesus Christ. You want to put your faith in Jesus Christ, saying, it's not what I do, it's not what I say, it's not how many services I watch, not how many services I attend, not how many good deeds I can pile up, but it's solely based on the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ alone that I am able to commune with the God of the universe. I want to give you the opportunity today. Text FBC1 to 41411, and we want to follow up with you. We want to help you take that step. And maybe you were listening today and you stepped across the line of faith and you're saying, yeah, I want to take my first step of obedience and I don't know what that looks like. Well, let me tell you that that is the step of baptism, and it's the easiest step because all God asks of us is to get wet for Him. We say it's like going Facebook official in your relationship with God. And if that is your next step, if you have been holding out on that and you want to know how you can get help at making that happen, text FBC1 to 41411. We want to help you take those steps. So if that's where you're at, for either of those, to step across the line of faith, to take the next step of baptism, text FBC1 to 41411. We want to help you with that. And maybe you've done both of those and you're seeing what that looks like. Well, you need to know in even the most dire circumstances, you need a plan. So think about what would it look like for you to live your life in a way where you bless the greatest amount of people for the greatest amount of time throughout the rest of your life. Do you have a plan to be faithful with what God has entrusted you with, to trust that He can take what you have and do far greater with it than you can do by yourself? One of the ways that you do that is when you give to your local church that you're doing life with, that you're in community with. Here at FBC, you can give through text by texting FBC to 77977. You can give online. You can mail a check in. The method does not matter. It's the heart in which you give. We say that we're sacrificially generous because the gospel is worth it. It enables us to partner with our community and to shine the light of Christ out into the onlooking world so that others may know the love of God, so that they may take the invitation to come and sit at His table, to come to His altar. This week, maybe you've been here for the last couple of weeks and you want to know how to get connected, how to take your next steps with the body to say, man, I am a part of the fellowship body. Well, immediately following this, we have a thing we call first steps, and we want to welcome you into that. And if that's what you want to do, you want to find out how to get connected in a community group, maybe how to get signed up for our summer online session of Rooted. We want to welcome you into that space. And just let you learn a little bit more about who we are to decide if you want to be a part. Unlike gym memberships, we're not going to just try to shuffle some fine print by you and just have you sign. We want you to know what you're getting into. And that's what takes place in something we call first steps. And it'll be something here online where you can interact and ask questions. And so the link to that is on the screen where you can get to that first steps, if that's where you're at. So it's fbctopeka.com/I'm new. So if that's where you're at, then please get connected through first steps. Have a great week. Continue to power up, pour in, and spill out. And we'll see you next week.
Hi, families. My name is Keelan Smith, and I am the children's director. I am so excited to be in your home to talk through our children's message for this weekend. And this month, we've changed themes, and we're going to talk about unstuck and what it looks like to not give up. Our word for the month is determination, deciding it's worth it to finish what you started. And for doing that, I want to talk through some things about things that I love myself. I love coffee, and I also love Jayhawks. That's why I have a coffee mug. But I love watching the Jayhawks play basketball. And one of the things I love about it is the determination in any sport for you to finish what you started. And so every year, the Jayhawks are playing to get to the March Madness and to win that tournament, which probably was going to be our year this year. But anyways, besides that, I have a KU basketball. And actually, I have a couple of these. And One game that I absolutely love happened on February 13 of 2017. It was my favorite game, and a lot of KU fans probably will never forget it. It happened in Allen Fieldhouse, and we were going to lose at home against West Virginia. We were down by 14 points with 2 minutes and 58 seconds to go in the game. People started leaving Allen Fieldhouse. They had given up on their players on the court. They picked up, they started leaving. But on the court, you saw a determination switch in the game. The players decided that they were going to lock in and finish what they started. And so that's what they did. With determination, the Jayhawks ended up winning that game 84-80. And sometimes we might feel like the Jayhawks in our lives. Sometimes we might feel like that. We might feel stuck. And we might feel like we are looking up at an uphill battle that is impossible. You might feel stuck in your home right now, right, families? You might feel, kids, that you're having to finish up a school year that's been difficult. You might feel like you are having to get along with a sibling or even have a hard thing with a relationship that's in your life, and you feel stuck and you feel like it is impossible. And so today's story, we are going to talk through determination, and we're going to talk through what that looked like with the disciples after Jesus left and so and ascended. Jesus at this time had resurrected, and we are going to be in Acts and Matthew today. Kids, do you remember where Acts and Matthew are? If you said New Testament, you are right. They are in the New Testament, and we're going to take a look first at Acts, because Jesus had a plan for his disciples, and he is getting ready to show them the disciples, even though in them they might feel like something is impossible or they feel defeated. But what it says is in Acts 4, we read, "And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father." Okay, so we're going to pause there. Jesus was giving direction. What was his instruction? His instruction was to wait for the promise of the Father. And then we read on to Acts 1:5, and it says, "For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." And this is Jesus telling his disciples the promise. The promise was the Holy Spirit was going to come upon them. And then we read in Acts 1:8, it says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." In Acts 1:8, that's what it says. The Holy Spirit was going to be with the disciples, and they were going to go, and they were going to tell the good news to everyone. And this is what I want to show you, a picture of Israel at this time. If you look on the screen, this is Israel. And this is where Jesus was with them and telling them, "You are going to go, you're going to spread, and you are going to share the good news." And imagine what they were thinking at that time. And then look, this is the New Testament world. And this is where they were headed. And if you even think now, right now, we are all hearing about Jesus. We were hearing about Jesus because disciples in Jerusalem were given a job. They were supposed to go, and they were supposed to spread, and they were supposed to tell about the good news of Jesus' death for all of our sins on the cross and for raising for the dead. And that when we believe that, we get to live with him forever. There's no mark. There's no thing that we have to reach. We get the love of Christ in us. We get the Holy Spirit in us. And we get to go and spread the good news ourselves because of what Jesus did on the cross, not what we did, but what he did. And they said, "From one end to the earth to the other." Wow. If we had a map of our whole entire world, that would be amazing, because the disciples went and did their job. And then those people did their job. And then those people did their job. And it continued on for us that we now get to share the good news. But let me tell you something. They couldn't do that on their own. They could not do that on our own. We could not do that on our own. I'm going to flip to Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 through 20. And it says, "And Jesus came and said to them, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I have commanded you. And behold, get this, behold, I am with you always to the end of age. I am with you. That's Jesus's promise that he is with them. They could not go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations by themselves. They could not do that. They had the power of the Holy Spirit within them. And that is one of the great, that's one of the great things about being a believer is that we get the gift of the Holy Spirit and we are not left on our own. We get the power within us to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, for us to go spread the good news, because it is not impossible with God. We want to keep going with determination when it seems impossible, because we can rely on the power of the Holy Spirit within us. But not only do we have the power of the Holy Spirit within us, we have the presence. We have the presence of him. We are promised both of those, the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit within us. What a great message that we can keep going, even when it feels impossible, because we have Jesus with us. That is a promise that will happen forever because God is faithful. So we need to go, therefore, because that is a command that we do as believers. Because guess what? This is the best news and the most loving news that we could share with anyone. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the gift of your presence and power within us. God, help us to love others, to share who you are with all nations, with everyone. Help us to do that, Lord. We know that through you that we have the power to do that. We thank you so much for everything that you have given us, all the blessings that you have given us, and help us to remember those in this time. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Families, I have a great question for you guys to talk about in this space together. What seems impossible to you? What is something that you guys feel that is impossible? Children, what is something right now that you feel that is impossible for you to do? And may you guys look to God during this time and you guys can have a great conversation about leaning on his power and his presence. Have a wonderful week.